clear to me at least that Calvin's sense of divinitatis is really concerned with the justification of religious beliefs, as the Reformed epistemologists think. It functions more like Paul's comments in Romans 1-2 to point out human culpability for sin. In any case, whether we think it rightly interprets Calvin's views or not, Calvin's understanding of the natural knowledge of God has been an important impetus for this approach to religious epistemology, and one that Plantinga and Walsdorf in particular have claimed as an historic precedent for their own creative work. So that's theme number one, the natural knowledge of God. Let's turn to a second theme in Calvin that has been influential in recent religious thought. This is the notion of union with Christ. Although the search for a central organizing principle to Calvin's work, or a central dogma, popular in the 19th century, it was a kind of cottage industry in the 19th century, has now thankfully been largely abandoned, the notion of union with Christ does do a lot of theological heavy lifting in his thought. As Karl Barth put it at one point in his Church Dogmatics, the notion of union with Christ, to quote Barth without the German accent, has a comprehensive and basic significance for Calvin. Indeed, we might almost call it his conception of the essence of Christianity, thus Barth. Others have taken up this call in more recent commentary on Calvin's work, Charles Partey being one of the best-known examples, following in the footsteps of the Scottish theologians and brothers James and Thomas Torrance. This theme is not merely a notion or idea, union with Christ. It is comprised of a cluster of concepts having to do with Calvin's understanding of the nature of salvation. Not only is union with Christ an important theme in Calvin's thought, it's also generated a great deal of scholarly dispute. This falls into two sorts. The first concerns the right interpretation of Calvin himself, the preserve of the Calvinians, as I'm calling them. The second has to do with the theological legacy Calvin bequeathed his intellectual heirs, that is, the Reformed theologians who have come after him. Let's tackle these two issues in turn. In so doing, we will give some account of the cluster of notions making up this concept of union with Christ as we survey the lie of the interpretive landscape, so to speak. As the first of these scholarly disputes about union with Christ, that is, the right understanding of Calvin himself, there are basically three sorts of approach in the current scholarly literature. The first emphasizes forensic aspects of Calvin's doctrine of justification by faith and minimizes those places where he speaks in ways that reflect more organic language of union. The second approach takes the opposite view, playing up the language of union and minimizing or even denying the forensic component of Calvin's work. And the final sort of view is a kind of middle way or via media that places the forensic language of justification within the broader context of his references to union with Christ. Where one finds oneself on the spectrum of views in this matter depends in large measure on what one makes of the relationship between the doctrine of justification and sanctification in Calvin's thought, alongside the related notion of regeneration, that is, the moment at which, or the process through which, an individual is brought to salvation through the secret working of the Holy Spirit. Calvin's understanding of justification was similar in basic outline to that of the German reformer Martin Luther. Like the Luther, though with different nuances, Calvin thought that fallen human beings have to be justified in the sight of God by means of the alien righteousness of Christ, that's his righteousness external to us, which is ascribed or imputed to the given individual. Calvin writes this by way of defining his view. Therefore, we explain justification simply as the acceptance with which God receives us into his favor as righteous men. And we say that it consists in the remission of sins and the imputation of Christ's righteousness. That's what Calvin says. God treats a fallen individual as if she or he were clothed with the righteousness of Christ, though strictly speaking they aren't in reality, so that he may declare the person righteous or justified. Because the person is justified by this declarative act, the believer may then be sanctified by the secret working of the Spirit, a process that is lifelong. In this way, Calvin's thought takes up broadly Augustinian themes about the way in which salvation is entirely a work of divine grace, but makes a distinction Augustine does not, treating justification as a quasi-judicial declarative act, whereupon the fallen human person may begin the lifelong task of growing in grace, which is sanctification. Although these two things are intimately related in Calvin's way of thinking, they are conceptually distinct. Augustine didn't make such a distinction, preferring instead to think of justification and sanctification together as one divine act in the human heart that takes place over a lifetime. In this way, Calvin and the other magisterial reformers might be regarded as the heirs to Augustine's understanding of unmerited divine grace received through faith in Christ, whereas the Tridentine decision on justification may be regarded as the heir to Augustine's particular account of the trajectory of justification in the Christian life. Both drew upon Augustine's thought, but in rather different ways, yielding rather different theological conclusions as a consequence. Well, let's call this Calvinian understanding of justification by grace through faith the forensic justification doctrine, since the idea is that God declares the individual righteous on the basis of Christ's work, the person is not made righteous through some infused grace. She is simply declared to be right before God and as a consequence accepted into his favor. Now, it may be thought that a declaration of this sort is a kind of divine speech act, which is a kind of speaking that brings about an action, like when someone declares, "I do" in a marriage ceremony. Just by saying something, you bring about an action. That's a speech act. The idea then might be that this is a divine speech act that could bring about the relevant change to the person about whom this declaration is made, so that by means of this very act of declaring a person righteous in justification, the person's status is changed just by that declaration. This is on analogy with legal situations in which a judge declares a person free to go, dropping all charges, whereupon the person who'd been in custody may now walk free from the court. We might say that the declarative act of the judge changes the status of the person accused. But for Calvin, although the declarative act of justification does change our status before God, bringing us into his favor, it's not equivalent to the moral change that is brought about in the human individual by means of the secret work of the Holy Spirit in regeneration. The declarative thing is kind of external. The moral change is internal, we might think, right? There is, in Calvin's language, a wondrous exchange here between the believer and Christ, so that the sin of the believer is imputed to Christ on the cross, and the righteousness of Christ is imputed to the believer by God in forensic justification. And because of this declarative act, the Holy Spirit may regenerate the individual, thereby uniting them with Christ in more than a merely forensic sense. This is what Calvin says on this matter, and I'm just going to give you a quote. "Therefore, that joining together of head and members, that indwelling of Christ in our hearts, in short, that mystical union, are accorded by us the highest degree of importance, so that Christ, having been made ours, makes us sharers with him in the gifts with which he has been endowed. We do not therefore contemplate him outside ourselves from afar in order that his righteousness may be imputed to us, but because we put on Christ and are engrafted into his body, in short, because he deigns to make us one with him." There is then, this is me now, not Calvin, there is then strong language about union with Christ that Calvin approves. But he doesn't like the idea, which he finds in the Lutheran renegade Andreas Osiander, that the forensic aspect of justification gets swallowed up, as it were, by language of union and participation. The order and the purposes of God seems to be justification first, then union with Christ by means of the regenerative act of the Holy Spirit. Or to put it another way, it looks like we're really and truly and mystically united to Christ, to use Calvin's language, by the Holy Spirit, because we've been accounted righteous by means of the wonderful exchange with Christ ascribed or imputed to us by God the Father. Now, earlier I said that Calvin's view on union with Christ has been the subject of much debate in recent Reformed theology, depending on whether one finds the forensic side of his approach appealing or the more organic metaphors of union. And this really goes to the heart of an important fault line in modern Reformed thought about where the emphasis should lie in discussing the nature of salvation. For some modern theologians, like the Princeton Bart scholar Bruce McCormack, This is a debate about the soul of the Reformation, whether modern Protestants wish to hold on to their heritage or give way to Platonizing tendencies that are fundamentally at odds to the concerns of the Reformation. However, I am more sympathetic to the views of Osiander, and strange to say, there are resources in the Reformed theology that press in that direction as well. Axiomatic to the exposition of justification in the theology of the 18th century New England Reformed theologian, Jonathan Edwards, is the notion that the real metaphysical union of the believer to Christ is the foundation of the legal or forensic declaration of God. And here's a little bit of Edwards for you. I could hardly come to Providence and not give you some Edwards. He says this: what is real in the union between Christ and his people is the foundation of what is legal. That is something really in them and between them, uniting them, that is the ground of the suitableness of their being accounted as one by the judge. And if there is any act or qualification in believers that is of that uniting nature, that is meet on that account, that the judge should look upon them and accept them as one, no wonder that upon the account of the same act or qualification he should accept the satisfaction merits of the one for the other, as if it were their satisfaction merits, it necessarily follows or is implied. But clearly Edwards has inverted Calvin's distinction between justification and union. For Calvin, it seems that justification is logically prior to union in regeneration, for Edwards, it's the other way around. The real union between Christ and his elect is logically prior to the ascription of Christ's righteousness in justification. Now, Edwards is not a modern theologian, of course. Nevertheless, he's an important voice in the Reformed tradition and a thinker whose work is increasingly looked to as a resource for constructive theology today. Importantly for our purposes, Edwards's position seems to be precisely the opposite of Calvin's, representing the triumph of union with Christ and full-blown participation language over the forensic. And yet, recent work on Calvin has suggested that the language of participation plays a more fundamental role than is sometimes thought. Thus, for instance, Julie Canlis and Karl Mosher have argued that Calvin, like a number of other Western theologians, has a doctrine of theosis or deification as part of his understanding of union with Christ and sanctification. If that is right, then the picture is rather more complicated than has previously been thought, and a lot closer to the sort of view one finds in later Reformed theologians like Edwards, who himself is most certainly a defender of a doctrine of theosis and a robust account of participation in the divine life. Okay, so natural knowledge of God, union with Christ. We turn now to our third notion or issue, the doctrine of election, the dreadful decree, as Calvin called it. The doctrine of election is often thought to be synonymous with Calvin's thought, even though his thinking in this area, as with so many others, was essentially borrowed from Augustine rather than made up whole cloth by Calvin himself. Although it's a commonplace in treatments of Calvin's doctrine to start by saying that his account of election was not a central and defining idea for his theology, it bears repeating, because he doesn't treat election in detail until Book 3 of the Institutes in the context of the Christian life, not, as it is in the work of much later Reformed theology, as something contained within the doctrine of God, or in protology, that is, the doctrine of first things. It was Karl Barth that took Calvin's doctrine of election and revolutionized it. This is so much the case that really all post-Barthian treatments of the doctrine are living in the shadow of his monumental theological achievement in this area. So it seems to me, at least. But we begin to get ahead of ourselves. Before saying something more about Barth's transformation of the Calvinian doctrine, we must say something more about Calvin's position. Let's describe it as Calvin's fork. This is the view that God ordains the salvation of some number of human beings, less than the total number, according to his good pleasure and will, as the letter of Ephesians tells us. These people are elect according to the will of God. Those who are not elect are passed over by divine grace. They perish in their sins, suffering the punishment in hell that is inevitable without the interposition of divine grace. These are the reprobate. So on Calvin's way of thinking, the eternal divine decision in election results in a bifurcation of the human race into two groups, hence the metaphor of the fork. It's God's decision, and then there's the fork at the end, the elect and the reprobate. More often, Calvin's doctrine is referred to as the doctrine of double predestination, since God predestines the elect and the reprobate. For some, it offers great comfort, which was Calvin's aim, although you may be surprised to hear that, and the reason why it was placed where it was in the Institutes after discussion about the nature of faith and salvation and in the context of the Christian life. I prefer to call it his fork because it's the means by which humanity is divided into two groups that are definitive of the eternal destiny of the individual members of these groups, irrespective of anything they do. Two questions immediately arise in discussion of Calvin's doctrine of election. The first is this: doesn't it make me a puppet in the hands of a divine puppet master, someone who has no control over his or her eternal destination? And isn't that an intolerable outcome for the Calvinist? The second question is this: what does it say about the deity who arranges matters thus? What kind of moral monster would Calvin have us worship? As to the first question, Calvin's doctrine doesn't deprive human beings of moral agency. His doctrine of total depravity, according to which all human beings are fallen and incapable of saving themselves because of the noetic effects of sin upon our minds, is not a means of tying off human moral agency, but circumscribing its limits. A quick illustration will help make the point. Consider someone addicted to some sort of substance like alcohol or cocaine. The addict is able to make all sorts of moral choices for which she is morally responsible. However, because she's an addict, certain choices are now beyond her metaphysical purview or grasp. They are off limits, choices she is incapable of making because of her addicted state. Thus, she cannot choose to kick her habit forthwith and without further ado. That choice is beyond her reach, and she cannot attain it without external help. In a similar manner, Calvin argues that our moral state is such that certain choices are off-limit because we are incapable of making them in our fallen state. We cannot choose to serve and love God from this moment forward without the interposition of divine grace. Indeed, salvation is entirely a work of grace for Calvin because it's a matter that is beyond our purview in this fallen state. It's beyond our grasp. How does this address election? Well, in this way. Calvin's position is consistent with human beings having responsibility for all sorts of actions, including important and significant actions. However, I cannot choose my salvation. That has to be the decision of God. But God cannot select me for inclusion within the number of the elect on the basis of any good that he sees in me, any character virtues or prospective goods that I might decide upon or bring about, because then my salvation would be due at least in part to my own good works. And that's semi-Pelagian. Instead, says Calvin, God ordains salvation independent of any merit I may or may not have, or any actions I may or may not bring about, according to his good pleasure and will, and nothing else. But this takes us straight to our second question, which has to do with the moral character of the deity that arranges matter thus. Calvin, like the Apostle Paul before him, may punt to mystery at this point. Who are you, O man, to accuse God, says Paul in Romans 9. But this isn't a very satisfactory answer, if it is an answer at all. For if nothing prevents God from willing the salvation of all humanity, why does he allow any to remain reprobate? It's at this juncture that we may return to Barth's response to Calvin. In Church Dogmatics 2.2, Barth sets out a magisterial account of election that's predicated on inverting Calvin's fork, so as to answer this problem about divine grace and the scope of salvation. Instead of starting with the eternal purposes of God that yield two predestined groups of human beings, the elect and the reprobate, we might begin with the rejection of God by fallen human beings and the need for their salvation. That is, we might begin, as it were, with the problem of the reprobate and elect, these two groups of predestined humans. Now, what if we think of them not as two distinct groups of humans, but as two ways of describing one human, two ways of being human that meet in the life of one individual? What if, in his grace, God sees that no human being will ever come to salvation absent divine grace and provides that grace for all? And what if the means by which this is brought about is the election and reprobation, not of one or other group of humanity, but of one individual, whose action is on behalf of the whole. That's exactly, for Barth, what God has done in Christ. He has elected Christ to be the true human, the one who is the elect of God and the one who is also reprobate. He is chosen to bring about salvation for humanity, but he is chosen to bring this about by being rejected on behalf of the rest of humanity. Thus, the two prongs of Calvin's fork don't divide humanity into two. Instead, they meet together in the person of Christ, on Barth's view. Moreover, because Christ is the elect one and the reprobate one, he's able to act in a vicarious manner for all humanity. Sin is still dealt with, its seriousness is acknowledged, but its presence in creation is no longer a reason for rejecting anyone. Rejection of God, on Barth's reckoning, must now be regarded as a kind of third residual element in creation, what he calls an impossible possibility. Whereas the second question we asked Calvin was how the deity could allow some to be reprobate and what this said about the divine character, with Barth, the question has changed to become, why are any rejected at all if Christ has taken the place of all? Although he's often accused of universalism, Barth's response is hopeful but not finally definitive. We can hope that all will be saved, but we can't be dogmatic about it, he thinks. This, he thinks, better tracks with the New Testament witness to Christ. And for this reason, Barth says of universalism, I do not teach it, but I also do not teach it. You know the Brits, they love their double negatives. That is, he does not affirm it, for who can know the scope of God's salvation? Yet he does not deny it either, for the same reason. This may be the best we can hope for, and it certainly seems to be an improvement on Calvin's doctrine, even if it's not without its shortcomings. So we've dealt with the natural knowledge of God, union with Christ, election. Fourth, our final topic is Calvin's doctrine of the Eucharist. Calvin's way of thinking about the Eucharist is sometimes referred to as receptionism, because a key element of the view is that the believer receives Christ in the elements of communion, and that these elements are the means by which a human soul is drawn into mystical union with Christ, so that if they're received with faith, then a real and a wonderful exchange takes place. In this context, however, the exchange is one whereby the believer truly communicates with Christ, who is really, though not corporeally, presented to the faithful by means of the elements. So he's really there, but not by means of his body. Hence, we might characterize Calvin's view as a doctrine of real, but not corporeal, presence. David Steinmetz makes the point that there's an important leitmotif in Calvin's thought that occurs in his natural theology and recurs here in his Eucharistic theology as well. This has to do with the distinction between what is offered by God and what is received by fallen human beings. Steinmetz writes this: Calvin argues that the substance of Christ's body and blood is offered to the congregation in the Eucharist whenever it's celebrated, but can only be received by faith. Men and women who lack faith participate in the simple meal of bread and wine and not in the spiritual real presence of Christ. Christ is truly offered, whether faith is present or absent. Christ is truly received only when faith is present. Thus Steinmetz. In 19th century American Presbyterian theology, there was some dispute about the reception of Calvin's doctrine. Although the Princetonian Charles Hodge, just up the road, thought himself the guardian of Reformed orthodoxy in a heated dispute with his former pupil and sometime colleague John Williamson Nevin, it became clear that his view was, in fact, more Zwinglian than Calvinian. Nevin's book, The Mystical Presence, set forth a high Reformed doctrine of the Eucharist, but one that reflected the teaching of Calvin as a version of real, non-corporeal mysticism that reflected Calvin's emphasis upon union with Christ as well. By contrast, Hodge thought of the Eucharist as an ordinance. He worried about any inroads made into Reformed thought by what he thought of as the excesses of idealist thought and resisted language of mysticism accordingly. Today, we find a similar sort of pattern emerging. There are those often called new Calvinists who think of themselves as the heirs of Calvinism. They favor the so-called 5 points of Calvinism that can be traced to the Synod of Dort in the early 17th century in the Netherlands, and could be summarized in the tulip acrostic, because of course tulips are from Amsterdam. The tulip acrostic goes like this: T for total depravity of human beings, U for unconditional election by God, L for limited atonement of the elect, I for irresistible grace, God's grace is irresistible in salvation, and P for the perseverance of the saints. Although there's much to be said in favor of the theological zeal with which some of these new Calvinists have pursued their theological agenda in the churches today, it's a rather truncated form of Calvinism that they espouse, and one that I think would have puzzled Calvin. One obvious example of this has to do with the nature of the church and sacraments. To return to the Eucharist, many of these new Calvinists, like Hodge in the 19th century, think of their view of the sacrament as Calvinist, though in fact their view is really Zwinglian in nature. In other words, like Zwingli, they tend to think that the Eucharist is a memorial feast, where Christ may be present by his Spirit, but not in any special way that implies some quasi-magical event taking place when the elements are blessed and manducated or eaten. Yet Calvin's position on the Eucharist, which, as I've already noted, reflects, seems to be found elsewhere in his theology about union with Christ and about receiving the presence of God by faith, is much more than a matter of mere remembrance. Christ is truly mystically faithful, present to the faithful. He is communicated to those receiving the elements by faith by means of the power of the Holy Spirit so that they may be nourished in their faith by Christ and drawn into ever greater and more intimate union with him. They are united with Christ by the power of the Spirit in this event. Let's turn then to the influence of Calvin's theology, having thought a little bit about these four central themes. The influence of Calvin's thought on subsequent theology, especially though not exclusively Reformed theology, has been enormous. We've only been able to scratch the surface today. Nevertheless, even in this cursory glance at several nodal issues in his work, we've seen how his views have influenced subsequent thought right up to the present day, even where that involves reconceptualizing what Calvin's trying to say, as with Barth. To have one's ideas discussed as the subject of live theological debate 500 years after they were first articulated is an indication of just how formative his views have been. In closing, I want to offer some comments on the deep themes that our discussion of Calvin's work have touched upon in passing, and then I'll end with some remarks about theological retrieval. The four topics we've considered reflect several key themes in Calvin's thought. These are his emphasis on absolute divine sovereignty over the created order and human destiny in particular, the hopeless state of fallen humankind without divine grace, the way in which God has fashioned us for fellowship and communion with God's self, and the way in which God provides the means by which we may be united with him in fellowship, participating in matters divine both in the declaration of justification and the secret working of the Holy Spirit in the human heart, but also in the nourishment of the Eucharistic meal. No wonder these themes have resonated with subsequent theologians. They get to the very heart of the Christian faith as much Protestantism has conceived it. But they've also been influential on the shape of subsequent Reformed theology. At the start of this talk, I said that Calvin is one of a number of important voices in the early Reformed tradition, which is true. Nevertheless, his place as a source for Reformed theology has meant that the four themes we've considered and the deeper ideas to which they're connected form a coherent theological framework that was built upon and adapted by many subsequent Reformed theologians. Aside from the clarity and simplicity with which he writes, the way in which he conveys the outline of his theological edifice to his readers with direct, immediate images and clear, unadorned prose is testimony to the power and clarity of his theological vision. That's something that marks out the greatest thinkers, including the greatest Christian theologians. I close with a note on the resourcing of contemporary theology with theology of the past. One common trope in contemporary systematic theology is the notion of retrieval, That is, reaching back to bring past ideas and arguments into present religious debate. Theology is always traditioned in some manner. It's always the case that theologians are in conversation with those who've gone before us, whose ideas have helped fashion the edifice of the church in different ways across time. We might say that theologians are in communion with the dead. Certainly, my wife talks about my dead friends that she worries I spend too much time with. Niccolo Machiavelli captures something of this when he writes, and here I quote him, "When evening comes, I return to my house and I go into my study, and on the threshold, I take off my everyday clothes, which are covered with mud and mire, and I put on regal and curial robes. And dressed in a more appropriate manner, I enter into the ancient courts of ancient men and am welcomed by them kindly. And there I taste the food that alone is mine, for which I was born. And there I am not ashamed to speak with them, to ask them for the reasons for their actions, and they, in their humanity, answer me. And for a few hours, I feel no boredom. I dismiss every affliction. I no longer fear poverty, nor do I tremble at the thought of death. I become completely part of them." Well, every scholar can resonate with that. But theology is neither necromancy nor intellectual archaeology. The conversations we have with thinkers of the past are never of merely historical interest in theology. They're always a means of resourcing our current theological concerns with the arguments of the past. That's what theological retrieval is about, fructifying the work of today with the best of the past as a means of pursuing a constructive theological project. Calvin is one of the greatest minds in Christian history. Not everything he says will be serviceable today, and not all of it will be helpful. Yet much of what he says resonates because he was able to speak beyond his own context and into ours. For as long as human beings care about God's relationship to his creation, his fashioning of us, and his plans for us and for our salvation, as understood in scripture and tradition, I venture to say that Calvin's thought will be the subject of debate, and his theological vision will be a resource to which theologians will continue to turn with great benefit. Thank you.